session. My name is Sergei Perepolitsa, and I am very appreciated to invite for the lecture Professor Francesca Mocci from Cagliari University. This is very beautiful place, very nice university in Island, in Sardinia. Francesca Mocci is a world-known scientist in the field of computational biophysics and NMR spectroscopy. She is a group leader in Cagliari University. And today we will have a talk about different methods, that simulation methods that may be used for modeling of nucleic acids. So, Francesca, you have 45 minutes in your disposal, including questions.
Thank you very much. So, good afternoon to everybody. And I would like to start with thanking you, Sergei, thanking the organizing committee to inviting me to this event. And well organized in such a way that it can work continuously, be unpacked and packed continuously. And the way that this packing occurs is still not known completely. I mean, there are a lot of information, but a lot of knowledge is still missing. So the DNA structure of the double helix, I think, is the maybe only molecule whose structure is known by everybody. It's the elegant shape of the double helix, which in our cell wrap around some proteins called histones, forming a complex that is called nucleosome core particle. So this disc here on around which DNA wrap form the NCP, nucleosome core particle. And these nucleosome core particles group together in fiber of larger size, which again aggregate in higher structure, forming loops, and finally reaching the shape of the chromosomes in our cell. Not all the DNA in our cell, by the way, is DNA duplex. Indeed, it has been demonstrated experimentally, but it was hypothesized since many decades. The DNA can organize also in quadruple helix shape, in which we have not only two base pair binding to each other, like in the double helix. Here there is one of the base pair cytosine binding with guanine in a double helix. In the quadruple helix, four base pairs bind to each other through hydrogen bonds. So also other type of structure are present in the nucleus, and many more in the cell. For RNA and DNA less organized. And if we consider the time scale in the bio world, is also a very, we have a very large range of time scale, because the phenomena that are of interest for DNA, such as the damaging through the interaction with the UV lights, which occurs in sub-femto time scale, sub-femto second time scale, occur much, much faster than other phenomena that are of relevance for nucleic acid, such as the DNA replication by DNA polymerase, as shown here in this graph, which occurs in the second or longer time scale. And how can we study with modeling these phenomena? Well, the method that we decide to use depends on the sites of the system that we want to study and the time scale of the phenomenon that we want to study. And for phenomena occurring in the space scale and the time scale indicated in these slides, we can study the system at a very resolved fine-grained level. We can study the system at the resolution of nuclei and electrons if we study system of pretty reduced size and using quantum mechanical methods, so basically solving the Schrödinger equation with some approximation. These methods are necessary anytime that we want to study electronic and electronic structures, reaction, catalysis mechanism, and so on. But when we have to study system of a larger size or for a longer time length, we cannot, even if the capability of the computers and of the software are developing continuously, still we cannot use quantum mechanical method. We have to use, when we want to study, for example, the structure and the dynamics of several DNA fragments, or when we want to study the dynamics and the thermodynamics of neat or mixed liquid, as it will be the case of the next talk given by Dr. Leon Engelbrecht, or when we want to study interfaces, we have to go to a coarser grain of simulation level, which is the atomistic simulation. But when we want to simulate a system or even larger size and study phase transition, or for example, going back to DNA, DNA condensation among long DNA sequence or interaction with polymers for DNA vehiculation, it's very useful or necessary to work, simulate particles which are at a higher, at a coarser level than the atoms. And basically we reduce the number of particles that we have to model by grouping atoms in the system in larger grains that we call coarse grain. If we want to simulate a system for longer time or time scale or larger space scale, we have to use a yet other type of model, of method, such as the lattice Boltzmann or continuum method, in which we don't have any more atomic particles, but of which I will not speak in this talk. Very often it is important to use, to understand the phenomenon, several different level of simulation. And a field that is developing and is gaining more and more importance in the modeling community, and in general for the chemistry and physics, is the multiscale method development. Indeed, in 2013, it was recognized the importance of the development of this method with the Nobel Prize to three scientists that have developed some of these methods, Leavitt, and Karplus, and in the multi-scale method are of at least two types. The type for which the Nobel Prize was given, by the way, is the simultaneous embedded multi-scale method, in which method that are developed for different time and length scale, such as quantum mechanical simulation and atomistic or coarse grain simulation, are used simultaneously by the development of some method that can treat the interface and enable the method to communicate. Another type of multi-scale method is the hierarchical multiscale method, in which starting from a model at high resolution, for example, quantum mechanical method, we develop a coarser method that keep only the information that are relevant for the application and reached one level of resolution, we can further reduce the resolution successively applying this method to the simulation obtained at the intermediate level. Many questions that are still open or debated concerning the DNA structure require the use of several of this level of theory. So, for example, there is still a lot to know about how the sequence of a base pair affect the flexibility of DNA and how it wraps around the nucleosome and how this flexibility and sequence dependent are modified by the particular ions that are present in the solution, or how the condensation occurs, or how the concentration of the ions affect it and why. And how the particles that are formed by DNA wrapping around the protein in the nucleosome core particle organized within the fiber, because there are hypotheses, there are some experimental evidence, but still there are many questions open. And this question cannot be solved by simply simulation of the system at the quantum or the atomistic level, and coarse grain and multiscale method are required. In atomistic simulation, I will recall here the force field expression that is used in atomistic simulation. We model the energy, the potential energy of the system as a sum of contributions coming from the bonding interaction, as for example, the stretching of the bonds or the bending of the bond angles, or the energy that is connected to the torsion around the bonds in the molecule. And also we include in the description of the interaction the so-called non-bonded interaction, which are those interaction among atoms which are either separated by more than three bonds, or that belong to different molecules, and these are typically modeled using repulsive and attractive potential for the van der Waals interaction and the Coulomb potential for the electrostatic interactions. In the coarse grain model, the grain that we consider should be larger than the atom, and the model has to be simpler than the all atom model. And there are basically two approaches to obtain a coarse grain model. One is the top-down model, and the other is the bottom-up model. We have seen today an example of top-down model in the talk of Cristina Anducchi. I hope I pronounced well her name. A very nice presentation about an empirical model and what is the basis, when is a model defined as a top-down model? When the model is built on the basis of some important features of the molecule. So for example, DNA is a linear molecule, but some other molecule like starch are ramificated and need a different description. And then we build a molecule using some parameter that is adjusted to reproduce some experimental data. And there are different type of top-down model, very different between each other. And I will describe to give an idea different from, for example, the one presented by Cristina. I will speak about two models that have been widely used and are still developed, still going on in their development in the recent year, which are the DePablo and the Oxford DNA model or Aldrich model that are used to study the DNA denaturation and renaturation and other properties. But it's important to underline that the field is a field that is expanding a lot. There are now many more methods which are still developing. Also the Martini force field has been developed in the last years for DNA and RNA. And so also other models exist. But here I just want to give an idea on how the grain are can be described and defined. And how the energy of the system can be described. In the DePablo model, which exists since 10 years, and as I said, it's still been developed, it's the nucleotide, which comprise, let's say, an aromatic base, a sugar, and the phosphate group are described instead that by the all atom, which are represented here in the representation, by free beads that comprise all these atoms. And the energy of the system is described by the sum of several terms, some of which reminds the term in the atomistic description that we have seen before, and some other term, like the solvation parameter in this case, are optimized to reproduce the thermodynamics of the melting. The electrostatic interaction are treated with a simplified treatment as the Debye-Ackel. This type of system, this type of model for DNA is able to reproduce thermal properties such as the, let's say, denaturation of the DNA from which pass, for example, from the form of double helix to single helix chain, or vice versa, the hybridization of the DNA, which that from two separate single strand becomes a double helix, and can reproduce also properties such as the heat capacity and physical mechanical properties such as the persistent length, which is an indicator very much used in the validation of coarse grain model for nucleic acid, which is a measure of the molecular rigidity. And this model can reproduce it also as a function of the ionic strength. However, this type of model, because of the way it is constructed, it is not addressed to reproduce structure of the DNA which are deviating from the standard double helix form, which is called BDNA. In addition, the treatment of the electrostatic cannot be used to describe phenomena such as the DNA condensation and chromatin folding, which depend on the particular nature of the salt that is used. Definition of the bead in a coarse grain model and their relative position can be different. So, for example, in another model, which is the Oxford DNA model, which exists also for RNA, the beads are all in the same line, differently from the model of De Pablo, and the expression also of the potential energy comprise different terms. However, independently from how the bits are connected and what is the number of the bits, depending on the parametrization of the model, in this case it was parametrized against the melting temperature and the structure of single-stranded and double-stranded DNA and RNA, the model can be able to reproduce the property of interest, which in this case are, again, the thermodynamics of the stacking, the formation of the double helix, or the denaturation, and also the persistent length of a single and double helix DNA. But again, also in this case, this type of method cannot be used to study specific interaction with the DNA cationes, which can interact specifically depending on the particular nature of the ions. So let's consider, for example, lithium versus potassium. They have a different interaction with the DNA. So, for example, lithium can interact with the oxygen in the phosphate in direct contact and still keeping its hydration sphere, and other ions cannot. So the nature, not only the charge of the particle, are important. And it's very important, the specific interaction, to understand the behavior of the interaction of DNA with polyamine, which are widely present in the DNA natural environment in the nucleus of the cell. The bottom-up coarse grain approach differs from the top-down approach because the model is developed on the basis of statistical mechanics in a systematic way from a finer grain model. So, for example, a coarse grain model where there are several atoms in each grain can be developed from an atomistic description of the system, or an atomistic description of a system can be developed systematically from a quantum mechanical description of the same. The property this type of model reproduce are not experimental property, but properties that can be either of structural nature or forces of or energetic natures that are obtained from atomistic or quantum mechanical calculation. And different different group work on the development of bottom-up approach from with the core screen method based on the structural properties, like the group with which we collaborate of Professor Laxon and then Lubartsev, but there are other groups like that of Florida Muller plate or Saveliev and Papoyan and others that are developing other useful and important model, and other groups are developing coarse grain model based on the reproduction of the force, like the group of Voth and Noid. So I would like to give just a few idea of how this method work and on some basic difference with the other top-down approach. One important aspect is that it's not necessary in this case in the development of this type of coarse grain model, it's not necessary to have a functional form for the interaction potential. We can simply map it on a grid without giving any specific function, except for the interaction of electrostatic type at long range that can be treated as with a Coulombic term. And the type of beads, the number of particles that can be in each of the beads, depend largely on the model or on the scale that we want to simulate. And here I showed a three beads per nucleotide model or one bead per nucleotide model. Or here we have a model where five beads are used to reproduce two base pair. How are these potential developed starting from the atomistic simulation? First of all, an atomistic simulation, which can be a molecular dynamics or a Monte Carlo simulation, are performed with the biomolecules, but it can be also another type of molecule, DNA, protein, or ionic liquids. We are using also for this type of molecules. And the solvent. Then, based on the necessity on the of what we want to simulate, we have to decide how to group the atom of the molecule that we are simulating and map the atom in the coarser grained bead. In doing this, we can remove from the simulation in the next step the solvent, which in the simulation of biomolecules is the part of the system which in which we generally are not interested in, but it takes most of the time for the calculation. And in this method, we can remove it from the description, but keep its effect on the function, on the interaction energy that we obtain. After we decide how to group the atom in the bead, we can decide how to connect them, and then calculate the related distribution function, which can be radial distribution function, as in this case, from two atoms, the radial distribution function between two atoms, or can be the distribution angular distribution function. From the radial distribution function, we can obtain a gas potential as potential of mean force and use this potential on a trial coarse grain simulation. From the coarse grain simulation, we can calculate again the distribution function and compare with that obtained in the atomistic simulation in black in this representation. And at the beginning, in the first iteration, generally the radial distribution function that we obtain is very different. But we can, on the basis of the difference between the obtained radial distribution function and those atomistic, we can adjust the potential and minimize the difference until and repeat these stages until the atomistic and the coarse grain distribution function do overlap. This method have been shown since its beginning, more than two decades ago, to be able to reproduce the different interaction of different alkaline ions with DNA, and while keeping the information of the solvation through the fact that the peak in the radial distribution function that the coarse grain model reproduce are due also to the presence of the solvent, and it has been shown that it can reproduce the mechanical properties of DNA double strand very well, and it can be included sequence specificity. In addition, this type of method can be recursively applied to the system of interest by starting as an example from an atomistic simulation here of a coarse grain nucleosome core particle that I mentioned before when speaking about the DNA packaging in the cell. First, from an atomistic simulation, we developed a first level coarse grain model, like this shown here with a larger particle. Then we simulate with coarse grain model and we obtain a super coarse grain model that can allow then to obtain, to study the interaction among many nucleosome core particle, which would never be accessible by atomistic scale. But this method can be applied also to study non-conventional DNA conformation, such as DNA quadruplex that I mentioned before. And for example, here are shown different type of wrapping of the DNA chain in forming a quadruplex. And we have used this method to study the quadruplex because there are experimental evidence that several quadruplex can stack with each other and form higher order structure which are not amenable by atomistic simulation. And here, just to show an example, starting from atomistic simulation with more than 10,000 particles, we can reduce through the coarse grain method our system to comprising the ion to 21 coarse grain particles. And then once we have developed the potential for this type of structure, we can use to develop very long chain of quadruplex and study the properties. Here I will leave the slides because only 3 minutes are missing. And obtain the properties of persistent length as a function of the ion's concentration or as a function of the length of the polymer on time and length scale that would not be accessible on the atomistic level. And the method can be applied to any type of system, also to lipids and study the formation of micelle. We are now working in order to use it to study with Dr. Pere Pelizia the condensation of DNA through the interaction of polyamine. Here there is the drawing which is copyright of S. Pere Pelizia, but where S is not Sergio, but Sofia, the daughter, which was very impressed and already interested. I don't know how old she is, less than 10, I think. And make this lovely drawing. And when speaking about the extension of this model to new system, I have to mention one of the limits that this method have, that if we change the system that we want to model or the counter ion that we want to model, we have to repeat the simulation at the atomistic scale on the small portion of the system in order to obtain the potential. And the potential that we need to have are known to converge pretty slowly. Also, I would like to underline that there is no best model for the best multi-scale or coarse grain model. I hope that with this talk, one message will be clear. Depending on the property that you want to study, you have to choose the coarse grain and the multi-scale method. And of course, increasing the level of approximation in the description of the system, the type of application that you can have for a model are decreased. Furthermore, I want to add that in the bottom-up approach that we are pursuing, any limitation in the atomistic simulation, or if you start from the quantum model, is the same, is any limitation of the founding method is retained in the coarse grain model. And also I want to underline again that there are also other methods besides those I described and that are becoming more and more common, also mixed method, which have a part of a top-down and part of bottom-up approach mixed that I could not describe within this time. With this, I want to kindly thank you for your attention, and I'm open to questions that you might have.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much for a very interesting lecture. Please, if somebody wants to ask a question, we have a time.
Can I maybe?
Yes, Timofey, Doctor of Science, Timofey Nikolaenko, please.
Thank you. The question is very simple. Do you believe the semi-empirical quantum chemical methods, for example, those developed by Stefan Grimme recently, are worth considering for similar kinds of problems, or it's not the right scale?
For which type of problem? Thank you for your question. Can you please repeat the type of problem you want to study?
For example, going from stacks of several nucleotides to the longer pieces of DNA strand on that scale, for example.
I think they are useful. Yeah, I think they are useful. I can only say in principle because it has not been done, but with the bottom-up approach, better is the description. And depending on the semi-empirical method choose, it can be rather good. And for unusual structure of DNA, even better than the atomistic one, because I did not mention, but unusual structure of DNA, such as quadruplex of DNA or of RNA or single-stranded RNA or DNA, have known problem in their description with atomistic force fields. So semi-empirical description can be in many cases a very good alternative where atomistic force field failed. And this semi-empirical method can be used now to simulate rather large system compared to ab initio quantum method. So yes, I think it can be useful to explore.
Okay, other questions? So I would like also to ask a question about top-down and bottom-up approaches. As I understand, in the case of bottom-up approach, we cannot do anything with temperature. So if we use the temperature in atomistic simulation, we obtain the potentials that are valid for this temperature. But in the case of from top to down, as I understand, we can have some opportunity to study the temperature dependence. Can we do something with this approach in the case of from bottom to up to improve the potentials to have the temperature dependence? These two approaches to have some temperature dependence. Actually, you in the end of the talk, you told that you there is some hybrid models that may be used. Can you say something also about this?
Very good question, also this one, thank you. The temperature dependence of some phenomena can be reproduced with accurate tuning of the parameters used in the dynamics. Some temperature dependent phenomena can be simulated, can be modeled. My idea of using the bottom-up approach that I showed for temperature-dependent phenomena would be to check how much the potential vary in trend first on the atomistic simulation, and then check if what I see with purely coarse grain simulation at a different temperature are able to reproduce those behavior, and then move to other temperature. But I think it's a very delicate step. There is not a track to follow and have a safe results without checking some point, at least when you're having a curve of the trend, without underlying atomistic simulation on smaller scale.
I see. Thank you very much. Thank you once again for a very interesting lecture. And now we go into the next speaker. This is Leon Engelbrecht from Cagliari University. And the title of the talk is Excess Thermodynamic Properties of Binary Liquids, Liquid Mixtures of Butanol Isomers with D-N-butyl ester at 298.15 kelvins and 0.1 megapascal pressure. Please, Leon, yes, I can hear you, I can see you. Please share your screen.
Okay, thank you, Sergei. And I would also like to thank the organizers for the opportunity to present my work. Just a moment. Can you see my screen?
No, Sergei? Not yet. Please, we can.
Yes.
We can wait. So
just a moment.
Try once again.
When I say share screen, okay. I see.
Okay. Now, now we can see. We can see your screen. This is your presentation. You can do the full screen.
Okay.
Okay. Please start.
Okay, thank you, Sergei. And I would like to thank the organizers for the opportunity.